Computer Science E-1. My name is David Barlen, and this is Lecture 7. Welcome again.
Not bad, huh? So welcome. This is, in fact, Lecture 7, Multimedia. I have the fortune of using both Macs and PCs tonight. Tonight is a particularly fun lecture because it is pretty much 2 hours of playing around and having fun with demos, multimedia, sound, audio, and the like. Before we proceed, I thought I would introduce you, if you didn't see in our workshop or sections thus far, one of the neat features of Mac OS. Its utility is perhaps of questionable value, but it's nonetheless hours worth of amusement simply by playing around with these voices. For instance, we just heard from Agnes. We can also hear from, shall we say, Fred. We can see the same, hear the same.
Welcome to Computer Science E1. My name is David Malan, and this is Lecture 7.
So this is, of course, voice synthesis. This is actually the voice, if you used Macs many years ago, 10 or so years ago, that was dubbed the talking moose. There were neat features even years ago whereby you could, with a mic and a very careful and deliberate speech, say, for instance, empty trash. And on a good day, your Macintosh would respond by actually emptying the trash. And there exists software these days that do this sort of thing as well, both on Macs and PCs. It's not necessarily the best of technologies just yet, but it's getting there. For instance, how many of you have called 411 or information these days? Well, they've automated a lot of that. They have far fewer humans working for them, so far as I can tell, because they use voice recognition software, which is sort of the analog of voice synthesis in the other direction, with which to recognize people's voices. It's a terribly hard problem, and even you have probably experienced some frustrations just with those damn voice prompts on 800 numbers these days, where they ask you to speak what you want, and you know, half of the time, 30% of the time, they just don't get it right. But the technology is getting there, and with increasing processor speeds, computers are getting fast enough to do even more analysis on someone's voice to get those kinds of answers right. Now, as I said, this can give one hours of amusement. At least it did me one night when I was playing around with a friend's Macintosh. I particularly am a fan of this whisper voice. And you can, with this same kind of software, achieve, for instance, the same. So with that said, let's do a quick segue to tonight's first of several visual demonstrations, something that will perhaps excite you for what's to come in just about 3 weeks hence. I give you an example of QuickTime video. I do not give you an example of QuickTime video. One moment. Well, that was anticlimactic. Let's try this again. All right. Well, fortunately, we can rewind and start class over, of course. Let's try this again without the quite the same anticipation, perhaps, this time. Here we go. All right. That's unfortunate. We're going to go to a different demo, one that was not just downloaded 5 minutes ago to be the latest. Instead, let's go ahead and do this, something that similarly came out quite recently, albeit this time on DVD. I give you a QuickTime video. Oh, Jesus Christ. Let's try it.
Yes, Master.
So the point tonight is not so much just to watch these movies, but also to get something out of them. So among the things that struck you about this demo just before was what? It was not DVD quality, for instance. What did you notice instead? Either. So what you just saw was what's called, again, a QuickTime movie. It is clearly a trailer for a popular motion picture, but it wasn't quite of the same quality that you would see if you actually went to the theater or if you actually now rented this on DVD. What did you notice about the movie itself on the screen? Yeah, it's kind of pixelated, but what do you mean by pixelated? Okay. So pixels, we've heard that term before. What is a pixel again? Yeah, it's all those dots on your screen. So a computer monitor has some resolution, usually. What's a common resolution for a monitor? That's for a very nice monitor. 1600 by 1200 would be a nice 21-inch monitor. More common is perhaps 800 by 600, 1024 by 768. These were some of the numbers we saw previously. If I actually view a bit of information on this film, show movie info, what we'll see in the top right here is a few statistics, one of which, in the second to last line, says that the normal size of this video is only 480 by 206 pixels. Well, now the resolution of my monitor currently is 1024 by 768. So if I blow this thing up to nearly full screen as I try to here, what does that sort of suggest about what the quality should be when I've blown it up to that resolution? It's going to be less clear, because even though it might look crystalline clear at a size like this, if you essentially double or triple the size of the window just so that it fills your screen, well, the computer is going to compensate by making pixels that once looked like this, for instance, look instead like this. To the human eye, that begins to look like splotchiness. And this is a reality of most any type of graphic file format these days, or video file format, a whole suite of which we'll take a look at tonight. But before we dive into multimedia that is both audio and visual in nature, let's start with some of the basics, the alphabet soup that is a number of the file formats that exist today. And let's start with those pertaining solely to graphics. Can you cite for me one example of a graphical file format with which you're already well familiar? A JPEG, I heard? Let's start a bit of a running list here. So graphical file formats include JPEG. What else? Bitmap, abbreviated BMP. TIFF is another one. Aren't we good at reading them off the list as well? What else? Okay, GIF, or probably more properly pronounced GIF, as per the creator's naming of it. Somewhat counterintuitive, but GIF versus JPEG. Any others come to mind? PNGs, PNGs, sure. Anything else? Any others? For graphics, EPS is another one that's somewhat common, at least in the graphics industry, or those of you who work in desktop publishing, putting together brochures perhaps for the office or the like. Well, let's see if we can now expound on some of these things. Let's pluck off one of the easiest ones, because every one of you has seen a JPEG multiple times on the web, including our own website. When what types of images have you seen as JPEGs? Sorry? Pictures, what do you, pictures, graphics are all pictures. What kind of pictures? Yeah, like photographs. So JPEGs are particularly well suited to digital photos for the reason that they support a lot of colors, but they also support compression. Well, let's expound on that. JPEGs support, as I alluded to in previous lectures, 24-bit color. Now, what does that mean? Well, we know what bits are, and we've actually talked about 8-bit color and 16-bit color and 24-bit color in our hardware lectures. Recall 8-bit color. If my monitor is currently set to display 8-bit color, what does that really mean? Well, not black and white. It's not that bad. That would be 1-bit color. It would be 0 black or 1 white. But if you have 8 bits, you can do better. 256 total colors. 256 colors. So if you recall, we've looked at my display control panel on my PC, and when we've changed or talked about changing color settings, Windows allows you to choose from 256 colors, 65,536 colors, a number that's come up before, and millions of colors. Well, 24-bit color is millions of colors. That's sort of the layperson's simplification of what is mathematically the value 2 to the 24, which is roughly in the millions. Okay, but JPEGs also support the notion of compression, which we'll revisit in a little bit. But just generally speaking, what does it mean if I say that a JPEG is compressed? It's smaller, and so what's the value of making a file like a JPEG smaller? You can put a lot of them on a disk, so you can certainly fit more on a disk. What else is the value of compression? You eliminate redundant information, and we'll revisit that specifically in just a little bit. Why else is it useful to be able to compress digital photos? Yeah, so it's easier to transfer them or download them over a network connection. So sort of the counterpart to them fitting more of them on disk. Well, if they're small, it's similarly easy to download them more quickly because there's fewer bits to transmit across the wire. So this is a good thing for JPEGs because you can make what are otherwise fairly large photos relatively small. But of course, there's a trade-off, as we've seen even in our Star Wars trailer. Instinctively, what's going to happen the more you compress a file, the smaller you try to make it? Worse resolution. At some point, you're going to start throwing away actual information, right? Because if you have an image that's this big and you want to try compressing it, well, how are you going to get rid of some of those bits unless you just throw them away? Well, fortunately, the human eye can't really distinguish 2 to the 24 different colors, millions of colors, right? There's only so many different shades of red a human being can notice. So we can use that to our advantage. Even though our nice digital camera might pick up any of thousands of different shades of red, well, we can sort of simplify a graphic and just pick one shade of red to represent that gradient of reds, thereby using less information, using fewer bits, in effect, to represent the same data. But we'll come back to this in just a bit. Let's contrast JPEG for a moment with GIF. In what context have you seen GIF graphics? Yeah. Yeah. Okay, good. So icons, non-photo graphics that might be found on a web page. So I'll say icons and non-photos. The reason for this is that JPEGs, or rather GIFs, are similarly compressed, but they only offer 8-bit color, which means 256 different colors. So with that alone said, why immediately are JPEGs clearly better for representing photographs than a GIF is? In more color. Otherwise, even though the human, you might not be able to name the 257th color in your photo, but your eye can detect different gradients of colors in a photograph, and essentially you have a broader palette to use if you use JPEGs to store your photos than you do if you use GIFs. But, and we'll come back to this issue of compression again in just a little bit, JPEGs are what are called lossy compressed, kind of a funny but real word, whereas GIFs are losslessly. When you see that word, now you kind of might know what lossy means. So when you compress a GIF image, and when I say you, I mean whatever program you're using to create it, compresses a GIF image, well, it does so losslessly. In other words, it will attempt to make the file size smaller without actually sacrificing any visual quality. And there are clever tricks with which you can do this, which we'll see. JPEGs, by contrast, achieve compression by, yeah, throwing out what information might be unnecessary, but further throwing out more information such that the compression ultimately is lossy. In other words, the more you compress a JPEG, and you'll do this in section this coming week if you choose, the more you compress a JPEG, the more blurry, the more splotchy it will begin to get at a certain point, because you are losing quality by achieving higher compression. So it's simply a straightforward trade-off, and programs allow you to do this. So GIFs, JPEGs, probably the two most popular file formats for graphics on the web. Almost every web page you pull up today has many of these graphics embedded somewhere in the web page, including E1's own. Now, as an alternative to GIF, there is PNGs, Portable Network Graphic. This is a file format that is free of any potential royalty issues. If you were in the know a few years ago, Unisys is a company that claimed to have had a patent, essentially, intellectual property rights over the GIF file format, and there was all this scare for a while that all of a sudden they would have people just using GIFs would have to start paying royalties to this company who happened to essentially invent the file format or lay some intellectual claim to it. Programs today, even to save as GIFs, in order to have that feature functionality built into your program, my understanding is that they must pay royalties to support the creation of GIFs. To use them, though, correct me if I'm wrong, TFs, you do not need to pay such royalties. So the community on the web decided, you know what, let's just come up with an alternative file format. It's called PNG, Portable Network Graphic. It's meant to be used on web pages, but the beauty of it is that it, like JPEGs, supports 24-bit color. And it's meant to be really a better alternative, a freely available alternative to GIF. The fact of the matter is, most websites to this day still don't bother using PNG. It's simply not much of an issue. And in fact, there are some neat things you can do with GIFs that I didn't mention. If you've ever seen a, there's a horribly tacky website with lots of dancing frogs and things bouncing around on the screen, well, many of those graphics are GIFs, because GIFs also support animation. And they also support, finally, transparency. The neat thing about a GIF, unlike a lot of other file formats, is that you can make the background of a GIF transparent. Now, what does this mean? Well, typically, almost every file format, when you save it, is a square, or it's a rectangle of some sort, which means if you take a digital photo and then crop someone's head out of the photo so that you essentially have someone like this, you've cropped out everything else from the photo. So really, the only part of the photo that's of interest to you is this part of the photo. Well, when you go to save that image with a program like Photoshop or Microsoft Paint, well, even if you've erased everything in the background, the image, when you save it, will become a rectangle. And this background will probably become white or some static color. Well, the beautiful thing about a GIF that's quite useful on the web today is that you can specify with GIF that all of this stuff, yeah, it has to be in the shape of a rectangle ultimately, but you can make any part of the graphic transparent so that in reality the graphic is a rectangle, but whatever is behind it, say on a web page, like a nice wallpaper or background color, will shine through. And that's not something you can do with most of these other file formats. And not that hard to do when you have the right software. Bitmaps. Where have you seen a BMP before? Well, how about this? Ever seen that before? All right, so that is a BMP. BMP denotes bitmap file format. It's a Microsoft creation, and it is pretty much used for wallpapers on Windows systems. So a bitmap file format is by Microsoft, and it's used mostly for wallpapers, though you can use other graphics, including JPEGs, for wallpapers these days. What do I mean by wallpaper, incidentally? Yeah, the background of your desktop, whatever image you happen to put there. This is the default one for, say, Windows XP. Well, two more to pluck off our list before we dive in deeper to the more common ones, TIFF. Where, if anywhere, have you ever seen a TIFF file? Yeah? When you download weather. Yeah. So if you download high-quality satellite imagery, if you receive a fax via some electronic fax-based service that emails the fax to you, it often is received as a TIFF. If you're a graphic design artist and you design logos, for instance, and you want to draw very high-quality logos, you'll often save them as TIFFs because TIFFs lend themselves to being resized to very large versions and still look just as good as the smaller version. So essentially, these are used for high-resolution graphics. EPS is similar in spirit, similar in its application. I would similarly say, though this is a bit of a simplification, it too is used for high-resolution graphics. So if you ever work with the promotions department in your company or anyone involved in designing brochures or literature, quite often the types of graphics they will embed in those literatures are things like TIFFs and EPSs, not compressed file formats like JPEGs and GIFs, because the former, TIFFs and EPSs, they just scale much better. They lend themselves to much higher quality, higher resolution. But for the typical person, JPEG and GIF are probably the two most common. Yeah?
Quick question about JPEG and BMP. If both of them are 24 bit color, why does the expansion or compression of those two differ?
Why does the, they compress in different ways. They have different, we'll say, algorithms with which they compress data. Yeah.
So are any of these used for video?
Nope. Our focus for now is entirely based on graphics. So these are all static file formats, pictures that you look at and do not change, except with the exception of the animated GIF, which changes, but it's just like a slideshow of multiple graphics, is all. Well, I've been using this term bitmap a few times. Well, what do we mean by that? Well, most image file formats that you're familiar with are, underneath the hood, bitmapped file formats. Microsoft has usurped the term for this BMP file format, but almost every one of these on the board is a bitmapped file format. What that means is that the data, the picture, stored inside the file is simply represented as a pattern of dots, each of which has some color. In a graphical file format like JPEG that uses 24-bit color, each dot can be any one of a million or so different colors. So the file format is, in effect, using 24 bits to represent every pixel or every dot in the image. Now, this example here shows at the left a nice JPEG of a pretty mountain scene atop a lake. But what we've done is zoom in on a very small portion of the mountain peak, blowing up the image for you to see. And what you see then quite clearly, or quite unclearly, is the pixelation, or the splotchiness that occurs because the computer is simply saying, taking a pixel that used to look like this and blowing it up to look bigger, but to the human eye, this very quickly becomes illegible because there's simply not much resolution there. Contrast this now with a vector file format. Other types of file formats, including, for instance, EPS, and another which is less commonly used today, but is worth mentioning at least, was popular on Macs, PICT, the PICT file format years ago, still exists today, use what are called vectors. And games actually tend to use not static bitmap graphics, but vector-based graphics. Well, what does that mean? Well, if a file format uses vectors to store to store image data, it doesn't store a dot for each dot in the image. Rather, it stores mathematical formulas that together represent all of the different polygons and shapes inside of the graphic. So for instance, this selection of cheese here on the left, if it were stored as a pict file on, say, a Macintosh, well, there's color information in the file, but really the file is ultimately made up of a sort of wireframe, where each of those wires at right is the mathematical formula for, say, a circle or for a half circle, the formula for a rectangle or an ellipse. All of those shapes from geometry that you might not have had so much fun with at the time do, in the world of computer graphics, play a huge role. Because if you use mathematical formulas to represent a graphic like this, what that means is that they can scale to be infinitely large, because you simply multiply the formula by, say, some value, the number 2, to double the size, and everything scales quite nicely. Computer games today, and if you attend this weekend's workshop with Ray, you'll learn more about computer games and how they work. Well, the graphics in computer games are very often these days not represented as like a slideshow of bitmapped images, but movies that are defined by mathematical formula. This is why these days, to play some of the coolest games on the market, you need a really fast computer. You need a really fast processor or a really good video card, because among the things that computer or that video card has to do is to decode all of these formulas and sort of crunch all of these numbers, compute all of these mathematics in order to figure out what shapes to show on the screen at a given moment of time. You can kind of see this here. This is sort of a representative example of what a person might look like in a popular computer game. If you look closely, a lot of these characters are ultimately made up of polygons of very discrete shapes. They don't look as fluidly defined as a real human being does. There are often sharper edges, and you can sort of see them because they're using formulas essentially to represent the various shapes that make up, say, the torso or the legs of this computer figure here. But most of the static graphical formats that you see today in use on, say, the web, they're simply bitmapped file formats. But in games, in high quality graphics, do you see vector-based imagery?
For the vector, how does is there another intervening step to tell which pixel to turn on or which color to get? Or is that in the algorithm as well?
Yes. So in addition to the general shapes, there's also color information that is not. No, it's hard to simplify details like colors, but imagine that there's simply one additional, there's 24 additional bits for a formula that says make this a circle of this particular size and then fill it with yellow. And you don't have to say fill this dot with yellow, this dot with yellow, this dot with yellow. You can simply say fill the shape with yellow. But how it's done is very much file format specific. Question? Good question. Why do computer games tend to use vector-based imagery as opposed to bitmaps? Size. File size, literally. If you were to store all of the imagery in a computer game, and consider any of these shoot 'em up games that you may have at least seen in arcades or played yourself, where a character can move in an arbitrary number of directions, can move throughout a room, if you were using bitmapped images, what that would suggest is that you would effectively have to have a screenshot of all of the possible configurations that a computer player could be on the screen at once. And it would simply be huge to represent a game by way of static images for all the possible configurations that the game might be in. If you instead do things dynamically through mathematics, you can sort of represent what the background is and then execute the equations that define the player, and then meld the two together. You can do things on the fly, which is why you would need a fast computer to do that. I'll pause for a moment and do a quick plug for the workshop that's coming up this Saturday. For those of you local to campus, Ray will be presenting our games workshop this coming Saturday. It shall be a fun, if also retrospective, look at the games of today and yesteryear, including, I see on his agenda, Pong, Atari, Nintendo, the games that have come from Sony and Microsoft, the latest and greatest, along with a whole bunch of demos. So if you're curious to know what the kids are up to today, or if you are yourself a kid playing lots of games and want to learn more, I think you'll have a great time from the master of all things computer game related here this coming Saturday. Details are on the course's website. With that said, let's revisit this issue of compression. You'll notice that tonight's slides are really just an exercise in finding cutesy clip art rather than actually having intellectual material on them. They're visual cues for discussions we can have. This one, of course, suggesting compression. Well, we've already talked about what it means generally to compress data, but let's consider this more concretely, specifically by looking at a pair of flags. We have here two flags for which two countries? Good. All right. It went well, Germany and France. So we have here two flags, and I claim that one of these flags can be much more effectively compressed than the other. And it works as follows. Were each of these flags bitmapped images, in the truest sense, BMP images by Microsoft? Essentially, they look like they are roughly maybe 400 pixels across by 200 pixels down, give or take. That seems a reasonable estimation. Well, what that means is that inside of the bitmapped image would be 400 times 200 pixels making up the whole image. 400 across, 200 down for a total of 80,000 pixels. Each of those pixels, meanwhile, would have associated with it a color. And we would use to represent that color, in the case of bitmap, something like 16 bits or 24 bits, depending on the particular version. Okay, we would use some several bits to represent the color of each of these pixels. Now, what strikes you about the flag of Germany at top left? Just describe it from a sort of analytical perspective, right? Okay, it's darker, certainly, than the French flag. Okay, so curious is that the stripes are going horizontally. With both of these flags, neither nationality put all that much thought, it seems, into the flag, right? It's just three simple stripes. There's not much complexity, that is to say, to the flag. But yet we are using some number of bits for every one of the 80,000 pixels in these flags, even though you can summarize them as three horizontal stripes. You would hopefully not need 80,000 bits or more to say something as simple as that. And this is where file formats like GIF or JPEG come in, because they begin to take advantage of that simplicity, of that redundancy, and summarize the graphic as succinctly as possible, not as naively as possible by storing the color of every single dot in the picture. How, for instance, would you, a human, describe the flag verbally to me if I didn't know what it looked like in such a way that I could then draw it? How would you describe the German flag so that I, a newbie to the flag, could draw it? Okay, three horizontal bars of three colors. Okay, and then you would cite the three colors, like a black, a red, and a yellow, plus or minus the specific shade. Okay, so that's pretty succinct. And this is exactly what a file format like GIF does. Rather than saying the first pixel is black, the second pixel is black, the third pixel is black, the 400th pixel is black, the 80,000th pixel is yellow. Rather, GIF would simply say, the first pixel is black, and so are the next 399. The next row starts with a black pixel and repeats 399 more times. The third row starts with black, repeats 399 times. In other words, succinctly describing what each row in the flag looks like without saying it 400 separate times for each dot. So with that said, which of these files do you think would be smaller on disk? The German flag. Why? Right. So whereas with the French, with the German flag, you can essentially wave your hand at the entire row saying it's all the same. You can't quite do that with the French flag. You can only say, oh, you know what, the next 132 pixels are the same color. But then you have to stop and say, now I see a white pixel. Now the next 132 pixels are white. Oh, wait, next pixel's red. Then the next 132 pixels are red.
So pixels are always counted horizontally?
It's done horizontally. And so as proof of this, let's navigate for just a moment to the two GIFs here. We have, you can view these as thumbnails, we have the two GIF images, and we'll make these available online later to play with if you wish as well. German on the left, French on the right. If I now go into details mode on Windows, notice the difference in size. The DE large, which is Germany, is how big? 3 kilobytes, whereas the French flag is 5 kilobytes. And that's a simplification because it's not telling you exactly how many bytes, it's just rounding, but clearly the French flag is notably bigger. And that's the reason why. So why now is the GIF file format said to be lossless? Are you throwing away any information, really, by compressing in the manner we just described? No, it's all recoverable. You've not lost any information. You've just summarized it, but you haven't lost any information. You can recover the original form of the flag because you've just represented the same information more efficiently. This is in contrast, however, with something like JPEG. JPEG, by contrast, will begin to throw away information. And you can experiment with this if you wish in section. When you actually start creating graphics and saving graphics in the JPEG file format, the higher you compress the images. And by that I mean the more compression you specify via the file menu that should be applied to the image, the more splotchy it will become. Because the file format for JPEG is much more involved. It actually uses complicated mathematical formulas to compress the data and to sort of estimate what the picture could look like even if you did throw away information, whereas GIF is just much more straightforward. It just eliminates obvious redundancies. Consider this example here. This is an example, too, of what a GIF might be actually storing for a picture like the one on the left. If you have an apple on top of a blue backdrop, well, there's a lot of redundant information there, right? Most of the blue background, for instance, is the same throughout the whole picture. So just to reinforce what we just discussed with respect to the flags, even though the image, if it were saved as a GIF, would look to you on the screen like the one it left, what's really being stored in the file is something that's more like the version on the right. There's additional information saying, starts with blue, repeat, but the blue is not actually in the file, whereas it would be in an uncompressed version of the file. Okay, questions? Well, I keep alluding to section as well. In addition to this weekend's workshop, starting tonight and then continuing on Saturday, for the Saturday section is our designing GIFs, JPEGs, and PNGs section, in which you will actually get your hands dirty with probably the industry standard de facto graphics editing program called Photoshop. We don't typically promote particular software packages, but it is sort of the graphics design software. It's available on all of the computers on campus, and there's also a 30-day free trial that you can download from Adobe's website. This is linked on the course's website, because among the tasks in the current problem set is to design your own graphic using Adobe Photoshop. So you don't have to go out and buy this $500 product. You can download the 1 month trial version and pretty much do anything with it for 30 days that the real version would as well. And the task specifically at hand involves the following. If you've noticed, pretty much every day, including on Halloween, this banner atop the E1 website changes. And you can actually click on it to force it to change immediately. As it gets colder outside, you'll see these images move from the fall theme that we've designed to the wintry theme. And in just a couple of weeks' time, you'll also see it evolve into the student's theme. Because the graphic that you will need to create for this new problem set is a banner for you to write home about and tell your friends that your banner is now featured on the E1's website. We give you essentially a template so that ideally your image comes out to be the same shape as ours, but then the content is largely your own. And you'll see in this week's suite of sections exactly how to begin to do something like this in Adobe Photoshop. And then we'll ask that you sign it with your name or your initials or something otherwise anonymous. And I can't stress enough, how much better the website looks, in all humility, when you maintain that shape. And don't submit, as has happened in years past, rectangles. You'll notice that the graphic is somewhat nuanced, and it kind of slopes upward and moves then to the left. Well, we've had submissions that look more like rectangles. Just doesn't, it pains us to put those online. We will, but it does pain us. So with that said, there is a final portion to this problem set, which, if you've looked at the course's website, you'll notice that there's a bit of history here with these things called mouse pads. Well, as part of the extra credit for this new problem set, you will be challenged to design your own candidate for the fall 2005 mouse pad design. We have on the course's website the past 3 years' winners, and by winners I mean given the submissions from this semester's student body, at the end of the semester we'll take a vote from the class on which design you like best, and then among the things you will walk out of E1 with is your very own copy of the winning mouse pad on a nice thick mouse pad material. So that will be among your souvenirs at the course's end, and we encourage you to submit. Last year's winning submission, somewhat biased perhaps last year, was this one. The theme, as you'll see in the problem set, is that your design must somehow involve the notion of surviving computer science E1. And this was the theme last year, and the theme 2 years ago was sort of more to the point, I survived CSCI E1. Well, with that said, let's move on to things more flashy and more animated than just static graphics and move on to the world of, let's say, audio. So in the world of audio, there are a whole bunch of file formats. What is perhaps the audio file format with which you are most familiar today? Okay, a WAV file. That's even more arcane than the one that's on the tips of everyone's tongues these days. MP3. So with Napster came the whole MP3 revolution, and with the iPod came its movement from a sort of arcane file format nickname, MP3, into a sort of mainstream term describing the types of song files that you have on your computer. So among the audio file formats that exist in this world are, yes, WAV files, WAV files, MP3 files. What else, if anything, comes to mind? I'm sorry? AAA, okay. AIFF is another one. Well, let's leave it at that. There's, how about MIDI, for those of you who are somewhat musically inclined. You've heard, perhaps, Real Audio. And perhaps CD-DA. There's plenty more in the world. These are perhaps among the most popular. Where have you heard a WAV file before? Do I have to spoil it again? Give this just a second. Hey, where have you heard that sound before? Okay, so that's like the old startup sound for a Windows 95 or Windows 98 machine. Almost all of the beeps on a Windows machine, as we'll call them, are WAV files. And the useful thing to note about a WAV file is that it is uncompressed, which means if you record a conversation using the WAV file format, it gets very large very quickly. For instance, if we go to my own Windows XP machine's programs folder, accessories, entertainment. Sort of curious that sound recorder is under entertainment since it's of questionable entertainment value. We can do something like this. Hello, this is Lecture 7 of Computer Science E1, the title of which is software, Multimedia. Save.
Hello, this is Lecture 7 of Computer Science E1, the title of which is software.
It's good, I sound like an idiot twice now. So this was just saved somewhere on my hard drive as a WAV file. And that's because that is the default file format that Windows would use to save a file. But if we went and navigated my hard drive to find that file, you would find that it gets very large very quickly. Contrast this with something like MP3, which is a compressed file format that offers roughly 12x compression. Well, what do I mean by that? I mean, if you take a WAV file and turn it into an MP3, the MP3 is 1/12 the size. And yet it sounds almost as good to most human ears as the original WAV file. And this is the reason that MP3s became particularly popular for audio files, especially when people started downloading them over the internet. Literally, if you were storing songs on your computer as unadulterated, uncompressed WAV files, perfect quality, it would take 12 times longer to actually download that file. Whereas if you download the MP3, it downloads 12 times more quickly. And for most people, you can't really tell the difference unless you have a very finely tuned ear or a very high quality stereo system. But for most people, these more than suffice. These days, we can say that MP3s, we can make mention parenthetically that they're used on iPods and other MP3 players, though the iPod supports other audio file formats as well. MP3 is perhaps one of the most popularly used. And let's just jump down to the bottom of the list, CDDA. Where have you ever heard a CDDA file format? Sort of a leading question. Take a guess. On a CD. So if you buy a shrink-wrapped audio CD from Tower Records, the file format used to store the songs on that disc are called CDDA, Compact Disc Digital Audio. So CD music. These are similar in spirit, let's say, to WAV files. They're uncompressed files, 12 times larger than the equivalent MP3. Consider, after all, the fact that a CD-ROM is the same, really, in terms of its storage space as an audio CD. How many megabytes does a CD-ROM tend to store? Like 650 megabytes, give or take. Well, that is what is used to store the latest Bruce Springsteen album. How many songs are on the typical audio CD these days? Well, 10, give or take, probably. Now, presumably, these songs are filling up these discs. Otherwise, you wouldn't be getting box sets with multiple discs. You would get one disc with more songs. So for the most part, CDs, as you buy them from Tower Records, are filled with music. So if you have 650 megabytes per disc and roughly 10 songs per disc, how big is each of the CDDA files on there? Right, it's like 65 megabytes. Now, those of you who collect MP3s, how big is a typical MP3 file? It's usually like 3 or 4, maybe 6 megabytes. In other words, 1/12 of the size. And you can sort of appreciate it in more real terms when you compare it to the original file format, which was on an actual CD. Well, let's see if we can't contrast some of these file formats. We've heard, of course, this last week. Let me associate these with a program that will load more quickly for us. All right, we heard this. This was a WAV file, and it actually doesn't sound so good. Right, you can sort of hear some background sound. Why is that? Even though this is an uncompressed, presumably high-quality WAV file. Well, how would you get that file, that sound, into a computer? Right, you have some guy, whoever I downloaded this from, and I was not the guy, holding his microphone up to the TV when Jeopardy was on someday. So there's clearly some loss when you're just holding a cheap microphone up to your own TV. Well, how about something like an MP3? Well, you heard this on the way in. So this is a 3 megabyte MP3 file of an Enya song. So it's roughly 1/10 or 1/12 of the size of the original. And though this isn't maybe the best stereo system we have in here, it's tough to say that this is 1/12 as good as the CD would be. In fact, it's probably much closer in quality to the CD, at least so far as our ears are concerned, as the file size would suggest. In short, MP3 is much smaller, but much higher quality than you might expect. MIDI files, meanwhile, are used where? Any ideas? Yeah, so those of you who have ever experimented with your own digital synthesis of music, or if you have a keyboard that records musical notes, or if you can program an electronic keyboard with musical notes, A through G, well, how do you store those files on, how do you store such music on disk? Well, you store it literally in terms of musical notes, A sharp, B flat, and so forth. And the file format in which you do that is MIDI. So musical, let's say, compositions. In other words, this file format literally stores musical notes, and it's then up to the computer to synthesize those notes and make them sound like a real instrument. Here, for instance, is an example of a popular Beethoven movement. So notice, this song is 6 minutes, 19 seconds, and yet the file is only 90 kilobytes. Quite small, but why? Well, all that's inside of this file is the musical notes. It's up to my laptop to approximate the best possible orchestral sounds to that based on those musical notes. Contrast this now with the MP3 version of the same song. You actually have real instruments having been recorded at some performance. This song, too, is over 6 minutes. This one's 7 minutes, 4 seconds. But this file, meanwhile, is 6.5 megabytes. So quite the difference. But you probably wouldn't particularly enjoy listening to this on your iPod all day. So what else do we have here on the board? Well, we also have AIFF. We won't go into too much detail here because this is among the file formats. Macs used to use these a lot. It's still in use, but I would say that the most commonly used ones today are those we've noted already, in addition to, at least with respect to this course, real audio. So one of the file formats in which we make the course's lectures available is real audio. For those of you who have maybe slow network connections and can't really tolerate the jitteriness of the movie, well, you can listen to the audio-only version. But the curious thing about real audio is that it is a streaming file format, unlike the others we've just put up on the board. What does it mean if a file format is streaming? Comes up and disappears. Not quite. Chris? It is sent in chunks, but that would be true of any of these files as you begin to download them. Okay, you can only hear or see it while it's being delivered. That's true in a sense. Most streaming file formats can only be listened to or watched while you are connected to the network, because the software usually does not save copies of the file locally. But more generally speaking, a streaming file format is simply one that you can start playing before the whole file has been downloaded in its entirety. If you download an MP3 from the iTunes store or download MP3s from a variety of file sharing networks, before you can actually play it, you have to download the whole thing. And that might take 20 seconds. That might take an hour, depending on the speed of your connection and the speed of the server from which you're downloading it. However, when you try to watch, for instance, one of our lecture's videos or listen to the real audio version of it, usually you don't have to wait more than 5, maybe 30 seconds to begin hearing or seeing the lecture. That does not mean you have downloaded the 500 megabyte file that represents a typical lecture, but rather you've started downloading the first part of it. Your program has then started playing what you've already downloaded. Those of you who've been watching the lecture's videos sometimes, have you ever noticed it stall partway through? And then a few seconds later it resumes? Well, that's because these programs like RealPlayer maintain what's called a buffer, a number of bytes or megabytes that it fills up with the movie or the audio stream in advance, so that if you ever experience congestion on the network, all of a sudden your network connection gets slow, even if you can't download more of the lecture from the server, you at least have a buffer locally to start eating into and playing. But hopefully, this network connection will resume its original speed so that you can catch up without feeling a glitch. This is similar to those of you with Sony Discman, CD players, portable CD players. If you go jogging with these things or just generally shake them, usually you'll continue hearing your music playing okay, until you do this for more than 10 or 30 seconds, after which point what happens? it starts to skip. But that's because these Discman 2 have buffers in them where they can tolerate 10 or maybe 30 seconds of jostling, during which time the device is useless. It can't read more data because the CD and the laser beam are moving around too much. But as soon as you empty and use up what was in the buffer, just like with the streaming connection, then you experience a problem.
Does that go for sound as well as video?
For both sound as well as video, yes. Yes, so sometimes Real Player included, to deal with network congestion, will sometimes just say, you know what, forget about the video. Let's just continue giving the student the audio until it can catch up with the video. It's not necessarily ideal, but it's perhaps the best solution if you're using Real Audio, for instance, for a live streaming event. If you are actually listening to, say, a president's address or to some important event that's being streamed live, unlike these lectures, well, that you probably don't want to be made to wait. You'd rather just get what information is still coming across the wire. So let's give a little teaser here, because after break, we're going to have things much more visual, if exciting. And I will allude to them by giving us a little bit of a cappella during our break. Suffice it to say that following break, we will hear from these four horses. But for now, let's go ahead and take a 5-minute break. Doesn't take much to memorize the class. Mesmerize. All right, welcome back. Things are going to start getting pretty flashy and animated in just a moment. But a word on the surveys we had you fill out last week. The teaching fellows and I have looked over all of your feedback, all of it appreciated. I'll let the teaching fellows address what comments they may have received in sections or workshops. But there were three comments that I just wanted to address here. One of which was in lectures, what does David Malin not do well? Sometimes he's too fast, so that jargon and jargon and anything familiar to him are blurred on first hearing it to a neophyte. By all means, if I am ever speaking too quickly or something goes over your head, assume, and I think this is reasonable, that that probably just happened to someone else in the room as well. And just raise your hand, slow me down, put a look of fear on your face, and I will try to adjust accordingly. The only agenda here each night is to make sure that as much of it goes down as possible, not to meet exactly what's on the syllabus. So do let yourselves direct what goes on. Another comment we had was in lectures, what else could we do differently? It's hard to hear the questions asked in class and then fit in the answers. So if I interpret this correctly, I will do better to repeat the questions or summarize them, particularly for those folks on the lecture videos. And last but not least, in this one, I can take a little bit of constructive criticism, but this one just hurt. In lectures, what does David Malin not do well? Open windows. So, clever nonetheless. So what you see above you here is sort of our bridge between graphical and audio file formats. This is an example of a shockwave or flash file. This is a technology developed by Macromedia. If you've ever visited a website, that's really kind of cool, really interactive, lots of things flashing around, moving, lots of animations. Odds are it's based on flash technology, which in essence is a file format for audio and animations, if you will. And it supports interactivity so that you can click on things, as I've been, to trigger these horses to start speaking. For instance, if I add in just a moment the fourth here, this is just a cute little demonstration that someone put together some time ago. But the neat thing about Flash, which this file is, it ends with a file extension of .swf, shockwave flash, or shockwave file. Notice how well it scales. No matter how small or how large I make this thing, it looks quite crystal clear. And that's because these are not bitmapped file formats for animation, but rather vector-based. So there's mathematics underlying the scaling of these images so that they look much better on screen. How many of you now are Harvard affiliates or employees? Okay, so those of you affiliated with Harvard and those of you who have at least read the news are quite familiar with Larry Summers as the president of the university. Something an undergraduate did last year or so was use exactly this file format to spoof a popular rap song. And I thought a fun interlude here to further convey what's possible in the Shockwave or Flash file formats would be to demonstrate the following. This made its way around the Harvard campus about a year ago. So I give you the Shockwave file called Shaniqua.
Hello?
Cute animation, I think, to say the least, by Molly Claire Wilson, who was, I think, a senior in Elliott House. So download this today. So this is a relatively small file format, though. It clearly has music interlaced through it. It has animation. It scales quite well to be most any size. And the compelling reason to use something like this in a website these days is because you can do things that are much more interactive, much more fluid, much more impressive, if you will, than websites based solely on static or animated GIFs or JPEGs or similar file formats. You can really have a slick user interface such as those offered here. In fact, if we pull up an example of, let me see if I can recall the website, and this will be a recurring issue when we get to our website development lecture. So templatemonster.com is a useful website, if not to buy or download templates with which to develop corporate websites, to be inspired by some really neat designs. And I've poked around here in the past, and there are some neat ones. For instance, if we look at, see if I can find it, Flash templates, let's look in the category, I think, minimalist, if that is one of them. No, style, minimalist. So just to give you a sense of the sorts of websites that you can develop with this, let's pull up, for instance, and you can get incredibly lost and spend hours playing around with some of the really neat designs that people have done here. Let me further refine our search, because there's one that I have in mind. All of these are demos, essentially, of sites that you can purchase or download examples of. Let me go back to the main page real quick and choose, I think, what was the, no, okay, products, no. Well, let's go to the architecture, fashion, maybe it was. Okay, moving on. All right, maybe this is not the best choice for class time. We can instead choose, let's go back to minimalist and just pick one of those at random, just to give you a sense of what you can do with Flash interactivity on a website. Picking, for instance, this one, personal portfolio. Come on. All right, let's get this right. Okay, so with Flash, you can do things that you simply cannot do with the file formats we've discussed thus far tonight, GIFs and JPEGs. Notice how the hovering is happening, the sound that's happening as you hover over different elements. If we click Freshworks, the sheer animation, things bouncing around, just generally being quite impressive. The inevitable question, of course, is if you develop a website as flashy, as interactive as something like this, based on Macromedia's Flash technology, well, is it going to work for the end user? Are they going to be able to see your corporate or your personal website? Well, it's a worthy question with not necessarily a perfect answer. The short answer is that it depends. If you want your viewers to be able to view your website correctly, what do you think they need to have? They need to have this Flash technology installed. They need to have the free software that they can download from Macromedia's website so that they see this. Now, the upside is that most browsers today, including Internet Explorer and Netscape, Mozilla, Firefox, they tend to come with this Flash player installed. And on Macromedia's website, I looked it up before class, they claim that 97% of computers, you know, purchased before within some period of time now comes with such software as Flash installed by default, which is a useful thing because certainly for a corporate website, one of the most important things is that your customers be able to actually view it. You don't want people going away because they're sort of befuddled by the need to install some additional software. But of course, there's another consideration in mind when someone is downloading a website like this to view as opposed to something more static. What's another consideration for deploying something like this? The size of these files. Though they are relatively small, given that they are well compressed in terms of their use of vectors instead of bitmapped file formats, there's still an audio soundtrack here. And there's still got to be some number of bytes that compose all of the interactivity of this site. So both the file size and also the technical support for technology like this really drives people's decisions as to whether or not to use them. You'll find that most mainstream websites, CNN.com, for instance, don't get so flashy as this because they want to appeal to the 99th percentile of people out there, not just, say, the 97th. So it's an interesting question that we'll revisit, but these are just among the things you can do with something like Flash. You don't need to just spoof popular songs. Well, with that said, let's move on, not from our world of static graphics to audio to just now animation, and now to full-fledged movie or video file formats. Video file formats are many these days. You've seen several demoed already in class, one of which we saw earlier tonight was a file format called QuickTime. What are some other file formats out there today for video? I'm sorry? Okay, we have real video for such things as the course's lectures. What else? MPEGs as well, and I'll elaborate on the several different ones that exist. You have MPEG 1, you have MPEG 2, and more recently you have MPEG 4. We'll expound on each of these in just a moment. Any others come to mind? Well, there's a few others that we'll at least make mention of so that you're savvy with the lingo. AVI, DivX, and there's several others. Unfortunately, in the world of video, there are so many different competing file formats. Often, to play a video successfully, you need to download additional software. It's getting better, and a lot of the file formats out there today, you already have the software by default with your browser, as in the case of Flash, but it's not always the case, particularly for video. Well, let's tease these apart. How many of you have ever watched an MPEG 2 video before? You should know by now. Anytime I ask a question like that, everybody's hand should go up. Yeah, yes is the answer. Why? Where have you seen it? Where is the MPEG 2 file format used? Sorry? Not on our website. It's a, let's say it's a very high quality file format. Oh, I heard what I think is the right answer. The other type. DVDs. So a commercial DVD that you would rent from Blockbuster is nothing more than an MPEG-2 file containing sound and video on a disk. And there's some more content on there, so you get the menus and the different audio tracks and so forth. But fundamentally, at the end of the day, the file format, the big file, the multi-gigabyte file on that disk is an MPEG, an MPEG-2 specifically. MPEG-1s are similar. They are similarly a file format for video, but they're really meant for video downloads. So older, this is an older file format, usually used when you would download a clip of a movie. That would be it would be stored in the MPEG-1 file format. Incidentally, MP3, what does MP3 actually stand for? It's actually MPEG-1 layer 3. MPEG-1 layer 3. So all this time, when we've been talking about MP3s, we've essentially been talking about the audio counterpart, or just the audio track, from an MP1. MP3 is just sort of a better term, an easier term than saying MPEG-1 layer 3. But an MP3 is just this without the video. So you've certainly seen or used it before. MPEG-4 is newer. This is sort of what you download today. We'll call this the latest file format, or among the latest file formats for video. It essentially is better than something like MPEG-1. It achieves better compression, but higher quality. So essentially, over time, people, smart people, have developed better ways of compressing data while still maintaining high audio and visual quality. AVI, meanwhile, is a file format originally developed by Microsoft for video. It's still used today, but mostly for clips, similar to MPEG-1. DivX is newer, too. It's sort of in the same boat as something like QuickTime or MPEG-4. The confusion in a lot of these file formats comes in that, technically speaking, and you can just remember this for a fleeting moment, file formats like QuickTime and AVI and DivX, these are sort of like container file formats. They are a standard that allows you to then use other file formats inside of them. So for instance, you can have a QuickTime movie like the one we saw for the Star Wars 3 trailer, but the actual video inside that QuickTime movie is saved as MPEG-4. Or you can have, for instance, one of the other file formats for audio that we didn't mention earlier that wasn't on our board is a file format called AAC, popularized by Apple, and perhaps might be the default file format for the iPod. You can put MP3s on an iPod, but I believe the default file format for iTunes is called AAC. Similarly, can you have a QuickTime video, QuickTime file, the video of which inside is stored as MPEG-4, the audio of which is stored as AAC. So in short, simply I think familiarize yourself with the fact that these are each different types of file formats for video. What you usually need in order to play any such video file format is what's generally called a codec. A codec. A codec is just the type of software that knows how to play the video. How do you download the codecs? Well, if you download Windows Media Player, which comes by default with Windows, but you can download newer versions of it, essentially you get with the media player different codecs. In order to play each of these file formats, you need that specific codec. This is why, for instance, if you've ever wanted to watch a DVD movie on your hard drive, on your own computer, your desktop or your laptop, you can't usually just put the DVD in and then double click on it and play it. You would need to often install some additional software, some kind of DVD player. Well, among the things that DVD player gives you is the software, the codec, that knows how to decode the software on the DVD. But at the end of the day, even on a standard DVD from Blockbuster is just a file format. As an aside, DVDs, can you copy them? Okay, yes, how? So you can burn them. Often, though, they are quote unquote copyrighted, which means most software won't copy them. Come? They're often encrypted, too. There was a case a couple years ago now, a teenager, 18-year-old or so in, I forget the country, who hacked or wrote a program called DCSS, which was a program, a simple program, that actually decrypted industry DVDs. With this software, then, could you actually copy and then transmit over the internet DVD movies? There was a more recent situation involving, I think, a Sony file format, whereby their CD-ROMs or their DVD-ROMs were similarly copyrighted. So if you put them into a CD drive or DVD drive, you could not copy them. You would get an error message saying, this disk cannot be copied. Well, guess what it took to defeat that copyright protection? It didn't require an 18-year-old abroad to crack that. How did someone more locally defeat Sony's copy protection on their disk? Took a black, no joke, black Sharpie marker and drew a black line on the inside of the disk, literally covering up the part of the disk that had the copy protection, putting it into the drive and then copying it. This is sort of the computer equivalent of the BIC pen for the kryptonite locks. It literally was that simple. So the short of it is that a lot of these file formats offer copyright protection, intellectual property protection. iTunes, to some extent, tries to incorporate this sort of thing. All of these technologies can be defeated unless you have true industry support and truly closed doors. But I think the lesson is that as we move into this age of having more books online and having movies online, the fact of the matter is that the industry itself, the audio, the movie industry, the music industry, really has to accept the fact that once you put the content out there, it's out there. And you cannot maintain such tight rights. You can maintain the rights legally, but not so much technologically. All such things can be broken, including things like DVDs. Ah, good question. So if you download clips of movie shows, it really depends. But I can hypothesize that it's most likely to be QuickTime or MPEG-1 or AVI these days. Yeah?
My friend has a smartphone where he could download TV shows or whatever and watch it.
Mm-hmm.
If
you can download little TV shows to the phone, it depends. More likely a phone is using something like an MPEG-4. Codec to compress to play them, or it could be something proprietary. It's tough to say without seeing it.
You were talking about lossless
mm-hmm.
when you were talking about graphics,
mm.
and you were saying those were vector-based, correct?
Mm-hmm.
Now, is there also lossless audio or video, and if so, are they also vector-based?
It's an excellent question. So vectors do not apply in the world of audio compression, since it's simply a different context. Almost every audio compression file format is lossy, but there are a lot of frequencies and a lot of sounds that the human ear can't hear, or there's noise that you might as well throw away. So almost all audio compression is lossy, but you don't necessarily really hear it. MP3s, for instance, you achieve 1/12 the size, but it's hard to tell, unless you're a real audiophile, that it's worse than the actual CD version. With video, this is a perfect segue. Compression is achieved in part just like it is in the world of JPEGs. In fact, these file formats like MPEG, to some extent, are the application of ideas from the world of graphical file compression. But you can achieve two different types of compression in the world of video. You can have intra-frame compression, I-N-T-R-A, frame compression, but you can also have inter-frame compression. Well, by intra-frame compression, I mean exactly the same kinds of ideas as we saw in the world of GIF. Consider the reel at top here. Pretend this is a reel of film that you might see when playing a movie. So each square is a frame in the movie. And most movies are, say, 29 or 30 frames per second or 15 frames per second. So each of these is sort of a snapshot of the film from left to right. There's five different frames in the top one. Well, notice that in this picture, it's a small picture of a house and a tree in the background with some grass and sky, and then some kind of RV in the foreground. And that truck is moving across the frame over the course of these few seconds or so. Well, notice what's not changing. Yes, the car is moving, but the sky's still blue. The tree's still there. The house isn't moving. All of this is redundant information across the frames. So what you can do, for instance, with a video file format is achieve inter-frame compression by using what's called a keyframe. Say this frame defines the default picture for the movie, and then in subsequent frames, just tell me what changes. So if the sky doesn't change, don't bother storing a blue pixel for every dot in the sky. Just tell me it's unchanged. And then I'll leave the blue, me being the video player in this case, for that particular frame. Only once it finally changes significantly should you insert another keyframe that has more information than the intermediate frames. This is inter-frame compression in the sense that you're compressing information across frames, not just within the frame. Because you could certainly, within the frame, intra-frame compression, just apply our ideas from GIF and say, well, we don't need to represent a blue dot for every pixel in the sky, just the left-hand ones. So you can apply both types of ideas in the world of video. You can also, in the world of video, skip frames altogether. A lot of the clips that you'll download these days are jittery, and they're kind of jerky. If you download a news clip from CNN, it's not necessarily the smoothest of video, especially if you download the lowest quality version. Well, that's because another way to achieve compression is just to throw half of the movie away. Throw away every other frame so that you only have 15 frames per second, which means by nature you're not going to see such fluid movement on the screen. You're going to see the guy's hand moving more like this. It's sort of like, if you think back to childhood, those little flip books that sort of show you an animated cartoon. Well, if you flip those more slowly, it doesn't look like nearly as fluid an image. That's similar in the world of video. If you only show me 15 frames per second, it's not going to be as fluid. So the other way you can compress video is truly lossily with loss by just throwing frames away. And if you throw frames away, it is by definition lossy because you can't get back what you've literally thrown away. And that's what the lower picture here suggests, 15 frames per second rather than, say, 30.
But if you put it the other way where you're saying it repeats, it's redundant information,
mm-hmm.
That's lossless. You're not actually throwing away information.
Right. So lossless, for instance, would be this. If this, too, is video and we have a video of a bee flying over some flowers, well, if the flowers aren't changing but the bee is, we don't need to store the information on what's not changing. So in other words, if you can literally and conceptually recover the original content, it is lossless. You've just represented the same information more efficiently. But if you start throwing frames out, like in the bottom, well, there's no, you could guess what the intermediate frames looked like. You could, for instance, take this version and take that version and then morph them together so that you have sort of an intermediate frame. But that's what would be called interpolation. You're sort of guessing what should be there rather than storing what was there.
And you can't do lossless with just audio.
You can't do lossless. You can to some extent, but you can do lossless compression with audio, but it depends on the file. It depends how simple it is. If it is just dead air, then you could quite easily compress that into a trivial file. Say, don't play any sound for the next 30 seconds. But if it's a symphony or if it's a conversation and lots of different sounds, there's only so much redundant information in there. So it depends, is the short answer. Questions on file formats for video? Well, another fun, yep. Mm-hmm.
Does that mean that Windows Media Player can play QuickTime?
Yes and no. So Windows Media Player is probably the most common player for video on a PC because it comes with Windows, like most things from Microsoft. QuickTime is an additional piece of software that you would need to download or you get for free with your Macintosh that plays QuickTime as well as other file formats. I've been experimenting actually lately with opening QuickTime files in Windows Media Player, and the short of it is it doesn't work well. They don't play very nicely together, even if they share some common data. And this goes to my comments earlier when I said these are like containers for these file formats. They're sufficiently different, even though the innards happen to be the same in, say, a QuickTime container or an AVI container. It's the container that's different, and if Windows Media Player isn't designed to understand the new QuickTime file format, it will do something unexpected, or it will say, I cannot play this file.
So in order to play this different kind of platform,
you typically need to have the right kind of software. And typically, you'd be told from whatever context it is that you're downloading the video what software you happen to need. For instance, if you tried to watch the real videos for this course before installing RealPlayer, Internet Explorer would probably tell you or show you with a broken icon that I don't know how to play this file format, and you need to know to go install the right software. So relevant to tonight particularly is what we've been doing lately on the course's website. Of course, recall that we started podcasting the lectures not too long ago. This is, if you've not heard it before, Ray's voiceover that prefixes each of the videos.
On Thursday, October 27, 2005, visit us on the web at www.fas.harvard.edu/CSCIE1.
Does this sound familiar? So that was just last week. This is an MPEG of the lecture from last week, which was roughly a half an hour after lecture. If we look at the properties for this MP3, which is what we stored it as, how big is it? Yeah, 11.4 megabytes. That's not bad for a half an hour of audio. But that's because we compressed it particularly well. We used a very high compression rate, which is okay because for the most part, it's just my voice in lecture. We're not playing a symphony. We don't have lots of different sounds or Enya music playing full time. So there's a lot of dead air when I'm talking. A lot of dead air. I'm not even going to go there. When I'm talking. So you can throw away a lot of information, dare say all of the information that happens in lecture, and get it down to a fairly small file size. I also experimented this past weekend with video file formats as they relate to the course, and ultimately did something like this to include in our podcast. If I open this file up, which is a 6 megabyte MPEG-4 file, you'll see the following. And I'm going to fast forward since the intro is a little long. So we had this on the course's website for many months now, if you happen to look at it before registering for the course. But previously, it was only available in real video format, which meant you needed the real video software, you needed to install that on your computer, and then you needed to pull up this streaming video, which meant you couldn't save this locally, not that you would want to, but you could immediately start watching it before it had even downloaded in its entirety. Well, among our experiments this past weekend has been to deploy, for students' convenience, not only the audio tracks from lectures, but also in response to some requests, the videos as well. So this is a program called iTunes, if you've never used it. This is a popular program used when people own iPods these days, and people who even don't own iPods often use iTunes to play their MP3s. What I have installed on this particular computer is just a couple of files. This is what is our podcast. If you've sort of been wondering for the past few weeks, what is this podcast everybody seems to be talking about, or the general term podcast? Well, a podcast, as you will now understand it tonight, is just a cheesy marketing term that describes a process by which you download MP3s. All a podcast is, as we'll discuss this more in the future, it's an XML file. An XML file similar to HTML, which we'll look at in class, but essentially it's a text file that has information on it as to what the MP3's file names are, what the name of a lecture is, what the description of the lecture is. In short, and I'll show you this outright, if I log into the E1 course account, and actually we can do this from IE, I'm going to pull up the course's website and show you a file that's called iTunes.xml. This is a file. It looks a little cryptic, but it's just data with some markup, as it's called, with special tags. So notice at the top of this file, you see title, Harvard University's Computer Science E1, Understanding Computers and the Internet. A little below that, you see a description. And then you see the same description from the course's syllabus. Farther down, we can scroll, and we can see, for instance, these tags called items. Notice here, we have an item, the title of which is Lecture 1, Audio, Hardware. Among the things in this item element, as it's called, is the duration of this lecture, is a URL of the MP3 on Harvard's server, and also the file size in bytes. But what we also added to the feed now, for those of you with the latest gadget, the video iPod that you can walk around watching videos on, you also now have in the feed Lecture 1 video hardware. Notice that what file format is used for these videos? It's an MOV extension, which happens to be of type QuickTime. When you have a file ending in .mov, that means it's a QuickTime file. So not only are the videos, some of the videos now available in real video format, the course's first several lectures have been posted to the podcast so that you can download them to, say, iTunes, but more to the point, to a video iPod and actually play them locally. To see this, we can actually, in iTunes, double-click on, for instance, this, Lecture 6, and see in just a moment a very small icon here. But this is the lecture from last week, playing in the confines of iTunes. And if you've ever wanted to do something awkward, I suggest you go to the Cambridge Side Galleria at night to the Apple Store and download your own podcast to the video iPod to test it out and watch the funny stares as people wonder why a guy is in the Apple Store downloading videos of himself to hardware he doesn't even own. But it does work, is the conclusion. As of a few nights ago, I am still stored on the hard drive of one of the disks in the Galleria, but it works, which is pretty neat, actually, since the video iPod, recall, just came out about 2 weeks ago, 3 weeks ago now. And this is a way of riding that enthusiasm and letting you actually play with your with the videos yourselves on, say, video iPods, iTunes, or the like. Very much certainly integral to tonight's lecture because these video files are stored, again, in QuickTime file format. Specifically, they use, inside of the QuickTime container, the MPEG-4 file format and AAC for the audio encoding. In fact, let's be real computer geeks. Take a look real quickly at what this file is. If I go to look at the file and get information on it, what I'm going to do is open the same video file with QuickTime Player again, going up to the video window, show movie info. Let's take a look at what's inside of this video. So this is a .mov file, again, a QuickTime file. What is the size of this video in terms of its resolution? Yeah, so I heard a few numbers, but one, current size ignore because I blew up the screen quite large. But the normal size of this video is only 320 by 240 pixels. So it's not as high quality as, say, the best real video streams. The real video videos you can actually watch quite large and they look quite good these days. If you were to download something like this, it's a lower quality video, but that's fine when your screen, your physical device, an iPod is only yay big. But if we tried to blow up this video on my screen, which dare I try now, you would see that it is splotchy. So even splotchier than the Star Wars trailer that we looked at before, because I was careful to use particularly high compression for this video so that ultimately we have squeezed 2 hour lectures into, let's have a wow factor, how many megabytes? Sorry? But that would wow me too. Not 64. 10? Too small. 2 hours worth. So it's 200 megabytes. So that might sound large, but if you consider that a 6 minute MP3 tends to be about 6 megabytes itself, and now we have full motion video as well, it's actually quite in line with the compressed file formats we've looked at. Contrast this with the original videos, and Chris, how much space fits on a typical DV tape?
How much space?
Do you know how big these videos are in raw format?
1 hour.
Size-wise, how many megs? So as I recall, when we did the course last year and took the raw footage from this camera, each video, each tape tends to be, and we'll correct myself if I'm wrong later, a gigabyte of information, which means that it's very high quality video. It's a very expensive camera that we use here, but clearly we're shrinking things down quite a bit, throwing away a lot of resolution, and hence the splotchiness, but hence the convenience of downloading something that is only, quote unquote, 200 megabytes. What about the audio track in this file? What can we say about the quality of the audio? Well, it's in AAC format. What are some curious numbers related to the audio that you might see up there, albeit a little small? It's in mono, which seems a little atypical, but who cares if I'm talking this way or that way? So by throwing away one of the soundtracks and just having a mono soundtrack, we don't really sacrifice much quality because the mic is here, there really is no notion of left or right, or there need not be. So that's one way in which we can compress this video. What about that kilohertz thing there? What's that referring to? It's not quite the speed per se. This is what's called the sampling rate. So essentially, when you record audio, you sample the audio, the sound waves in the air, some number of times per second. What this suggests, being 32 kilohertz, is that we're sampling my voice, ultimately in these videos, 32,000 times per second. So when the sound waves coming out of my mouth, we're taking 32,000 clips of those per second. Had we taken more, a higher sampling rate, the videos would actually sound much better, but you can't really tell if it's just someone's voice talking. Were we to instead contrast it this way, a telephone conversation, the telephone system tends to support about 8 kilohertz. This is why telephones tend not to sound all that great, old landline telephones. Contrast that with a nice expensive stereo system, you're then talking 44 kilohertz as opposed to just 8 kilohertz for the amount of times that you're actually sampling the airwaves and then storing that information in the file. So questions on file formats for video, audio, or the like? Yes, and this is where the world of video gets a little confusing. A lot of these file formats are container formats that can use themselves other codecs, where the codec, again, is just the software that knows how to decode a specific type of content. But for the most part, people will just talk about it as a QuickTime movie and just trust that, for instance, their software knows how to play the movie no matter how it is actually stored underneath the hood. In fact, the last movie that I think we'll end with as an example of something that is also in QuickTime format, but in and of itself is also quite amusing. It's just a couple of minutes long, and if you've not seen it before, I think you'll get quite a kick out of the following. If you've not seen this, this was American Express's sort of novel approach to advertising about a year or so ago now. This was a commercial that never aired on TV, but was this sort of new web-savvy type of marketing whereby if you wanted to watch Amex's commercial, guess what you had to do? You had to go to their website, download a fairly large file, double-click it, and then watch the advertisement on your own computer. But I think if, like me, you like Jerry Seinfeld and Superman, the reason for people doing that will all make sense in just a moment. Here we go.
Two.
You have a reservation?
Superman.
I don't see anything.
You under Man of Steel?
Man of Steel. Man of Steel. Oh, yeah, Man of Steel. Right here. This way.
Why did you? Want to supply the kitchen?
No.
I mean, how can they put this much mayonnaise on tuna fish and expect people to eat it?
What do you care? You're invulnerable, huh?
It's not hard. It's too rich. Makes me queasy.
Come
back. Back.
You've got a little...
Why? It's impervious to stain.
Excuse me. Superman?
Yes.
I don't know if you remember me. Barry Katz, you saved my life once. I was hanging from a train trestle.
Yeah, sure, sure. Help.
Terrific. Great. I don't want to interrupt your deal. I just wanted to say thanks again.
No, not a problem. It's good to see you, Barry.
He's the best. You're cool, too. Thank you. Oh, what was that?
No idea.
So anyone help me hook up this DVD?
I thought we were going cycling.
Cycling would be what's going on.
Yeah.
It's just not. Anyway, I don't hear this thing. It's not surround sound.
I've always wanted that.
That's okay, Harry.
Yeah, but it's not surround sound. Surround sound. It's like you're there.
What are you talking about? So did you go bowling with those people last night?
No, I stayed home. I watched that rebound play.
Stop with the reality television. I can't.
I know, me too, but this one's pretty good. Now, Bruce Gass just got divorced, and he'll go back.
Please, stop. If I wanted reality, I'd take the screen out of my TV and look through the wood box.
Oh, boy. Look at these ideas. Unbelievable.
Oh, yes, Wyoming.
Now, this is what we should have seen.
What's wrong with you? Of course they only put the good ones. Every play does that.
No, that's Joel Siegel. You should trust him. Oh, yes, Wyoming. What a song.
Wow. Hey! I just saw my DVD player!
What am I not here?
Unbelievable!
How do you miss this?
Would you get over yourself? He's getting away.
He's not getting away.
Stop reading reviews!
So we hope you've enjoyed your glimpse into the world of multimedia. Over the next couple of weeks, we will finally explore that excitable topic of security, spyware, viruses, worms, which you've all been eager to hear a bit more about, we think. So we will see you then. In the meantime, we have multimedia tonight in section and games on Saturday. Sounds like a whole bunch of fun. See you next week.